I was in college at the time. My father started this little rug manufacturing business. He would buy up loads of damaged carpet from the carpet mills, little scraps of carpet, little small strips, and he'd have people chop them up and sew them around and make doormats and scatter rugs, stair treads out of them, and sell them to chain stores on these tables that Macy's had on the main floor in Herald Square. And that was great. So I would work in his business some weekends, maybe a couple of summers or vacations when I was in college, and I hated it. Absolutely hated it. The place was a sweatshop. Metal cantilever roof, the sun would beat down on you, carpet fibers flying everywhere, got all over my body, couldn't wait to get out of there, go home and take a shower. So one day I say to my dad, "Dad, your business is great, but thank you for sending me to college. I want no part of your business. Goodbye." So when I graduate from college, I get a job in the city working for Shell Oil Company as an accountant. So I'm with Shell Oil Company a year or so, maybe a year and a half. My father becomes terminally ill, and I have no choice but to go into the business because my mother had small children, and this was their only means of income. So here I was working in this business and sales and here and there. And my father dies after I'm there like a year. So there's a small business. Maybe we had four or five employees, very small. We had some people that cut rugs, some people that sewed them around and packed them in boxes. And we did this for a few years. And I said to my father, in the beginning, I said, "Dad, there's got to be a better way." I said, "There's a lot of work for no money." So after he passed on, I decided to switch the business around. In the early 70s or mid 70s, I decided to move the business to somewhere that we could also do some retail business, thinking that's where the big bucks was. So we actually moved to this business right here, this building. We started to do some retail business in addition to manufacturing. We called ourselves Rug Mills, Milburn Rug Mills. Maybe 10, 15 years or so, we decided that retail business is much better than making rugs. So we got rid of the manufacturing of rugs and we concentrated the whole building in flooring, retail flooring. And then Scott decides after high school that he's coming into the business.
I pretty much always worked at Milburn. Even during high school, I would come in, work in the warehouse.
When Scott was interested in joining the company, I wanted him to get experience in all the facets of it. I didn't want him just coming in and doing whatever he wanted to do.
He was more than a mentor to me. You know, he was my father, my boss, and a teacher. He's not an easy person to work for. He's a very structured, very organized, very controlling. But, you know, in another way, he is fair. In my early 20s, Mike Vandenberg came on, and both of us did not have the passion for retail.
So I grew up with a very simple background. My stepfather was an electrician for the town of Brookhaven, and my mother was a house cleaner. You know, it was a very simple living. You know, we lived in a very small home, four kids, no air conditioning, black and white television. But there's one thing that my stepfather and my mother instilled in me was having to work. I got my first job, I was 12 years old. I was washing dishes at a restaurant. I'd work until 12:30 at night on school nights, and then walk home, go to bed, go to school. It was just what we had to do. You know, there was not a lot of playtime in my household. It was always about work. You have to work, you have to get up and work. Nothing's for free. by the time I was 14, my parents stopped buying me clothes. You know, I had to pay rent in my house, $35 a week. And when I didn't have a job, that rent built up and I had to pay back rent. It was definitely a firm upbringing, but it taught me a lot. Taught me responsibility, taught me how to pay my bills. But the one thing I definitely knew for sure is I wanted a better life.
Mike came in one day and he applied for a job as a salesman. And I said, okay, we'll give him a shot. He was a great salesman. And he had worked for a company that did some commercial work, commercial flooring work. So he came to me one day and he said, you know, Charlie, I think that I can get us some commercial flooring. He said, how about if we start a commercial flooring division? I said, I'm not starting any division. You get the business and then we'll start the division, not the other way around.
But he would look at us too and be like, all right, idiots, where's the plan? I want it on paper. I want to see it well thought out. I want to see the end game. I want to see what the costs are. I want to see what your first step is, your next step, your third step. What's the out game? You know, if we run into a problem. And as much of a pain in the ass it was, it taught us how to be businessmen.
He went out and he worked very hard, and he wanted to quit a couple of times, but I wouldn't let him quit.
You know, we'd sell carpet and we'd do our thing, but when the times were slow, we'd always talk about bigger and better things. We got to doing some talking and we said, hey, maybe we'll go sell some commercial flooring. Who wants to sell, you know, grandma and grandpa, you know, a 9x12 bedroom carpet when you could go out and sell a whole store full of carpet or an office building or a school building or a court building. So we convinced his dad to let us go into the commercial flooring business. You'll see Charlie Coletti walking around here, and he is a very happy man, very kind. But he always wasn't that way. He was a very firm man. He was a very good man, a very honest man, a generous man, but he was firm. So he was more than happy to let me and Scott start the commercial flooring business on our days off.
Once a week, we would go out. He would be the one who usually picked me up at 7:30 in the morning. And we would go around Long Island and visit schools, but we would also go after just about anything because we really had very little commercial business. We would spend 10, 12 hours together in the car, knocking on doors.
So after a few months of working 6-7 days a week, it really just didn't seem to be taking off, you know, and we were really struggling and having a hard time to get it off the ground. So an amazing thing happened. Scott and I walked into his dad's office and we said, this isn't working and we're just gonna stop doing it and we'll just go back to our 5-day work week schedule working in the carpet store.
And my father just looked up at us and basically blasted both of us and was like, who are you two to come in here and tell me what you two are and aren't doing? You know, we already invested X amount of dollars into doing this. You've been telling me all these positive things you're doing, and now you're just walking in here and telling me, oh, you've decided you're not having the commercial department is now over? I don't think so.
He goes, you're gonna go back out there, you're gonna sell commercial flooring until you succeed.
And if that didn't happen, this probably wouldn't have happened. Where we wouldn't be where we are today.
And we got our first job in Smithtown. It was the entry vestibule of an office building. It was $286.
It was the start of our commercial flooring business.
As time went on, we got our second job, our third job, our fourth job. We broke into our first school building. We were doing buildings in Manhattan, worked for New York City. Things really started taking off. So he let us ease out of the family business. We really started focusing on commercial. The future was in the commercial flooring business. So it was a hard pill for Scott's dad to swallow, but eventually we closed it. We closed the company because the commercial flooring company was just too successful and it needed our attention all the time.
Scott comes to me one day and he says, you know, Dad, he says, I want again, I want. He says, Dad, I want to make Mike a partner. I said, Scott, I don't know about that. I said, I don't know if Mike fits in. He's way too tall and he's not even Italian.
It seemed natural for him to be a partner. I mean, it's a family business. It's been a family business for now 65 years, but Mike has become a part of the family. And, you know, I didn't do this on my own. I did it fully with Mike.
You know, and it's a tribute to both of them that as an employee, if you give everything you got and you make yourself so important to the company that the company's gonna make sure you're taken care of. And that's what they did for me. And I certainly appreciate it. And we would do the same for anyone else that would make themselves so important that we couldn't live without you.
I want to do everything I could to keep that family value there because it is definitely what separates us and keeps the people here and keeps them wanting to be here.
We have Christmas parties. We still are very tight. When there's a problem, we all talk about it. Scott and I's door is always open for anyone to knock on it and ask us a question.
I take a lot of pride in making sure that our staff feels like they're well taken care of and that they're cared for.
We want them to feel as if this is their home because they spend more time here than they do with their families.
The employees are incredibly important because without the employees, you really have nothing. They are the backbone of the organization. That was definitely something that I learned from my father very early on. I remember my father always praising the guys in the warehouse for thanking them for, it's almost making me choke up, but sweeping the floors. And I remember asking him why that was so important to him. They're doing their job and doing it well. Why would I not praise them for doing a great job? He said everyone's job is important. And because of that, those warehouse guys kept those floors spotless.
And we want to make sure that every single person understands what our motto is, because we're only successful if from every person and every level is successful. If you think of it like a watch, the watch don't work unless every single piece is working. So whether you come into the company to be the CEO or a first day laborer, your job is equally as important, because we will fail if you don't do the right job. Today we're probably one of the largest commercial flooring companies, you know, in the Northeast. Our reputation is impeccable. You know, we branched out from just doing carpet, tile, linoleum, VCT, to a sports flooring division. We're probably one of the premier sports flooring companies in the nation. We've done gym floors as far away as South Korea. We're very good at what we do. And our biggest thing is making sure the customer's happy. We provide the best service that we could possibly provide. Probably worked in every single school building on Long Island, most in Westchester and Dutchess County. Colleges from Hofstra, Stony Brook, CW Post. We've worked in Adelphi. TV shows, we had the ABC account for years. We redo the sets, redid the sets of The View. Soap opera shows, Days of Our Lives. We did all their flooring work for a few decades. You take a 30-minute clip of News 12, and there's a good chance almost 90% of the times, they're walking on our flooring. The US Army had called us out to do a job in South Korea at Fort Humphrey. You know, that's the furthest job we did away. It was in the DMZ, the demilitarized zone, and we sent out a couple of guys to get the job done for them. We did West Point. You know, we did all the West Point football, you know, locker rooms, weight rooms, press boxes, and even better, we turned down the Knicks and the Nets. We told them we didn't want their business. They wanted it for free, and we thought we were better than free. I would have to say I probably had my most fun building the Paramount Theater in Huntington. Renew Restoration was set up as a company to just help me and Scott make some extra side money. You see, with the commercial flooring company, we worked for an insurance company, and the insurance company insured all the schools throughout the state. So when there was a big flood in the school, they would call us and say, hey, look, could you go do the flooring here? And they would have a company clean up the water and then send us in to do the flooring. And we were like, yeah, no problem. And then they loved how quick we responded and how great service we were. They said, hey, look, there's a little bit of water on the floor. Can you clean up that little bit of water and then replace the flooring? We were so elated to get that flooring business, we cleaned that water up free of charge. And we would go in and get that flooring job, and one job turned to two turned to three, and then all of a sudden our phone's busy 5, 6, 7 jobs a week calling from this insurance company. They loved us. And then, you know, one day the guy from the insurance company said to me, he goes, you know, you could charge for that water cleanup. And we're like, oh, we can, that's great. And he goes, well, you have to have a restoration company. You can't just do it as a flooring company. So me and my quick thinking said, well, don't worry, I have a restoration company too. And I ran back to the office, grabbed Scott, and I was like, Scott, I got an idea. Let's open a restoration company. You and me own the company, and we'll be able to bill out for some side money for the water cleanup. When this opportunity came up to make this extra money, we brought it to his dad and we said, hey, listen, do you mind? We'll open up this little company and we could bill for the water. Let us keep that water money. And he said, go right ahead. No problem. It's fine. You could do that. Well, that first year we billed out hundreds of thousands of dollars in water cleanup. So me and Scott are like, oh my God, we finally made it. We got all this extra money. We're going to really be able to be on Easy Street now. So his dad saw exactly how much money was there and goes, guys, listen, we got a problem. You see all that money you have? You used my credit to buy the machines. You used my warehouse to store the machines. You used my trucks to deliver the equipment. He goes, sounds like I'm a partner. So he took a third of the company and he generously let us have 66% of our own company. And that's where Renew started. We were just cleaning up puddles, trying to make a few extra bucks to make ends meet.
But then it started to grow, and we got this one big job, this Hicksville fire job. We went from doing maybe $750,000 to like $8 million 1 year. Mike and I have a very similar thought process in the fact that we feel like a company has to grow. You either grow or you die. If not, you're going to have to figure out every year of how to cut costs.
The growth is unlimited. We don't stop. And we don't want to grow more and more because we want money. We want to grow more and more because we want to keep everybody working. We don't want to ever lay anybody off.
We're a growth-driven company, so we will always look to grow, just not obscenely.
The thing that stands us out differently than everyone else is how much we all care about doing a great job. Everybody does. And if there's a bad apple in the group, we won't have to find him. Our workers will tell us. He's a bad apple and he don't fit. You know, it's the quality of work, it's the dedication we put into it, it's the care for keeping a facility clean and safe and neat and keeping the customer happy. You know, that's really where it separates us from everybody else. Our customers are the most important people in our world, and it's the only way we will be successful is if we maintain that attitude no matter how big we grow. Renew, Millburn, and Sunrise Door, our customer service has to be second to none. Our potential is endless. You know, I have dreams of taking restoration across the country, but it all started off just wanting to make a few extra bucks on a puddle. We'll be right back.